I'm going to ask Denise to sort of kick us off with just some framing slides, and then we'll get into the heart of the conversation.
Great. Okay. Well, thank you, Kevin. I appreciate that. As he said, I'm Denise Lowe, and I'm a senior instructional designer here. I'm also an adjunct faculty member that teaches in a couple of our colleges here. So I have some experience that way as well. And he's pretty much already told you the first part of what we hope to accomplish in this session with Open Pedagogy is, you know, that there's an awful lot of experience. I've been sitting in these sessions, and there's a lot of experience and knowledge in the participants that I've seen so far. And so if you see this link right here, and maybe Kevin or Amanda or somebody could put that into the chat, that is a document sharing thing where you can put in your questions, your comments. We certainly invite, we are not the only ones with the answers. We certainly invite anybody who has comments or expertise to answer those questions, and just go ahead. It's supposed to be very participatory, and you know, we invite you to do that. Let's move on to what is Open Pedagogy. So Open Pedagogy has basically now kind of been involved with focusing on learners and creation as creators and co-contributors to public knowledge. It is the OER process, because now Open Pedagogy and OER almost are sort of simultaneously used a lot of times. And the OER process, because of its licensing for open development and publication, allows Open Pedagogy to work. And so that's very important. And most of us know this. And so we're just going to provide you some framing slides, as Kevin said. One of the things that we want to look at when we're talking about Open Pedagogy is looking at, these are not disposable assignments. So it's going to require a shift in instructional thinking for faculty members oftentimes. If you're already involved in this, you've already gone through that shifting. But if you're not, and you're just beginning to start with it and use it, then disposable assignments are those assignments, as the quote says, that really don't add much value. They're practice assignments. They're things that the students complete in course and then the teacher grades, but they don't really add any relevancy to the world. What we are looking at with Open Pedagogy is content curation and contribution. So seeing something that's relevant for students, helping them become contributors to the, you know, idea marketplace, helping them curate, helping them create. And so thinking about them becoming part of the process of that learning development. And then it's also very inclusive. It's student engagement, because they have some choices. The assignments are relevant. It supports different forms of student expression, abilities, and strengths. It also, if most of you have probably seen some similarities between what adult learning principles are about and what we are talking about with Open Pedagogy. So it's very a lot focused on relevancy and immediacy and applicability. And that is what the students gain. So think of Open Pedagogy levels. When you are beginning to think of, what do I want to do to begin to engage with Open Pedagogy, think of it in terms of levels. Level one, maybe possibly being, you're just using some open resources and you're asking the students to kind of share their work. And level two kind of takes it up a step further. And maybe now they're actually developing some learning opportunities with you that are based on their work. And level three, maybe they are now creating and curating content that can go out to in the global world and can become more an idea that others can then grow on and can add to. So this is also something that we think of in terms of like scaffolding assignments. That's a very instructional design term that most people are familiar with. And so think of that in terms of Open Pedagogy as well. And then these are just some examples of what you can think of doing with Open Pedagogy. So like adapting or remixing OER, things that are out there, textbooks, problem sets, discussion questions within your courses, doing case studies and redoing them. And there's a lot of resources there that's been provided for you. You can actually build OER, so students can sort of reframe and rebuild the content in a way that's more representative or more creative for themselves. They can edit Wikipedia articles, which of course that can often, you know, you need to check them for accuracy, but they can go in and add content and edit and change and add their citations. They can apply existing organizations, so partnering with organizations to create something new, to do some research, marketing, whatever. If you teach any courses that have maybe a experiential learning or a student service component, this is very applicable to you because students are out there potentially working with organizations and looking at applying new things and stuff. So this could be something that you could take to the next level in terms of evidence-based approaches. Curating course content, you know, oftentimes allowing students to help the instructor define quiz questions or discussion prompts or even working on the syllabus. And we have an example of that later on. But sort of identifying the information in the course content that's important to them, that is relevant to them, that they feel like that they want to learn. And then, as I said, syllabus and curriculum co-creation. And so that's something that they can help with. They can give you examples. They can give you some ideas of what's going on. So just very quickly here, I want to share a couple of examples with you. One is like what we talked about, like teaching with Wikipedia, reviewing and analyzing existing content, correcting inaccurate information, which means that they have to dive in and they have to do some research and they have to provide proper citations. So it gets them interacting with content in a very collaborative and creative way. Helping to craft the question banks for the quizzes and the tests in the course or for surveys and whatever things that you like to use, providing constructive feedback. Other examples is doing higher level things, is doing web annotations. So annotating articles and things that are on the web, as well as utilizing open textbooks, existing open textbooks, where they might be rewriting case studies or they might be curating the content or just continuing to revise and add more to it. And we have lots of other examples that we can provide. But for now, I think, Kevin, that's probably a good place for us to sort of stop and see if anybody has some questions. So I'm just going to pause sharing right now, and then we can go from there. So I'm going to turn it back over to you for the moment.
Great. We already have a question in the document that talks about resources around student work being shown outside of the educational environment. And one of the links I included was to a great press book that's a guide to making open textbooks with students. And one of the elements of that link is a student agreement form. So it's sort of a release form for students to make sure that they understand that they're releasing their IP to the collective or the public domain or whatever the agreed upon licensing is. But I would encourage folks to have a conversation with their students at the forefront and really talk about what is the benefit to this. If you contribute to this, what is the benefit not only to the classroom or within the academic setting, but to your own professional? How does this get included within a professional setting? Having that conversation where that your contributions may not only help future students in your institution, but may be helping out a global cause, and that is something that can go into your professional portfolio, certainly helps. But I do think that there needs to be at least one lesson that talks about copyright implications so that the students understand what that means when they do release something under a Creative Commons license. That's a great question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. And I was going to add too that when you're thinking, we have a slide later on in the presentation I can certainly get to. But one of the things is before you begin to truly implement open pedagogy, because it is a different style of teaching, it's a different style of learning, the students need to be prepared for it. So Even as Kevin was saying about understanding the restrictions or the copyright or the licenses, but just understanding how the assignments are going to actually be designed and how it's going to work, and that they're the expectations for them in terms of the collaboration and the content creation that they are going to be expected to do. Because in many cases, especially if they've been in courses where it's more of the sage on the stage, then they don't have that. They haven't had that maybe opportunity. And so having some sample assignments, having some pieces of an assignment that can be as samples that you can give feedback to, that you can provide more information to them and get them understanding what it is they're going to be doing, I think is extremely helpful in the beginning.
There's another great question, Denise, about what are some of the examples being used in mathematics or other domains where there needs to be some type of repetitive practice, but doesn't necessarily want to be a throwaway assignment. And one of the ones that came to mind for me is equation development or test bank creation, mm-hmm. where folks within those disciplines where equation-based problems are key, is having the students actually create new problem sets. And not only coming up with the question, coming up with the right answer, but also coming up with the wrong answers are and documenting what a wrong step might have been to come to that wrong answer. And so in those cases, it shows a deeper of understanding because they have to explain and provide feedback on why it's right or wrong and anticipate what a wrong step in the process might be.
That's a great point. And I think that that can apply even beyond mathematics or the sciences. It can also apply to business. It can apply to any of the humanities, because a lot of times that's what you're wanting students to do, is take existing content that's out there and curate it and research it and determine what is right and what is maybe missing or what are the gaps. So having examples where they can absolutely decide or look at and say, where did the step go wrong, I think is a great learning experience and very relevant to help them learning for future. And along with those lines, in a lot of courses, you can do things like the note-taking, the collaborative note-taking on a document that is revised throughout the semester, that they are taking notes, study notes, things like that, the process, what went wrong, capturing that material to where it is of relevance to the students that are currently in that class, but also for future students, that may be taking that class. And so those are some of the existing kinds of things that you can do, some examples. Should There's I go ahead? Great, go ahead. Yeah, let's do that. I was going to go ahead and maybe show a few more other examples, but let's go ahead and do the question.
Well, another one was around having materials that somebody would like to make available through open access, and just having a question on how to begin in that process. And what I was recommending is really reaching out to your library. And if you have an OER librarian, that would be the perfect person. If not, if you have a copyright librarian, most likely that person's going to be able to help. If not, looking at creativecommons.org is another great resource that would walk you through the process of how to open license a piece of information. I would still work with your local librarian just so you can go through some copyright clearance and making sure you have the proper permissions to share the materials you have under an open license. And thank you for who added the scholar communications librarian to that. Mm-hmm. Denise, why don't you show us a couple more slides so we can sort of feed some of the questions.
All right. So hopefully you're seeing the screen again. So let's go on to a couple of other slides. So one approach is an introduction to an actual OER course. So in this case, students utilize OER for their own course productions. Their work was licensed as OER, and they used Tumblr page as an application to do their student work together. And they found it extremely useful for the student. It help them to build an awareness and to implement OER efforts in their own district. And when they started implementing and revising the OER into the discipline, then it became a capstone project that was based on OER. Because of how it was designed and the licensing, it was free by design, and it revised the content where needed, and the entire course was licensed as open education resource, and so therefore others could go in and do some work as well and continue that work. Another approach would be a sociology course. So they were working together to write a portion of the resource, as it says, focusing on social aspects of certain types of communities. And so the work was focused on social policy and research within the local community. And it was developed to revise a section of an OpenStax OER textbook. And so as it says here, you have to also think of things that could impact. COVID-19 did impact the availability of some students to participate at the time, but it turned out to be a really good assignment to engage students and to help them do something that was very applicable to that particular course. Another approach is in the interdisciplinary studies, where it was a partnership between world languages, English, and art, and they engaged with elementary students to create stories. So depending on the students' abilities and strengths, some provided narratives, others provided illustrations, some provided translations of the works into Spanish, and they created a collection of stories that was then released. And so that's a very collaborative creating of content approach that we're trying to get to. Another approach in US, I'm sorry.
Could you go back just one slide for a second?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love this particular story, and I just wanted to emphasize a little bit is that if you have the opportunity to use the talents within your classroom, there is the opportunity not to just necessarily have every student produce the same output or widget towards a product. In this case, they were using the talents of those three different departments to create a combined work together. And even though it was three different departments that were coming together, even within a given course, you may have somebody that is artistically talented that could be providing illustrations for a biology textbook, where you have somebody that's a little bit more in tune with the data, and you could have somebody that's better with the narrative. And so you can be playing on the strengths of your students within a given classroom to create that output while each one of them is showing, you know, competency or mastery within the course outcomes. Sorry, Denise, just wanted to emphasize this one.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely jump in whenever, because that's a very good point. And it's something I'm going to touch on a little bit later, too, when I talk about open pedagogy and AI, because that's a big thing that's going on. So another approach with U.S. history, for example, and this had to do with syllabus design. And so the process was that the instructor wanted the students to be involved with describing and drafting the assignments and the activities. And so, again, that introduction on the first day, the concept, what are we going to be doing? What are you expected? What are the expectations to not only identify their skills, but to build their skills? Because many students are not used to being as collaborative in this kind of content creation. So first of all, they brainstormed activities and assignments. This was the process, refine the list, create the survey, the students vote on what they, you know, like, and then revise the syllabus to reflect the top ranked activities and assignments. And then they helped in actually devising the assignments themselves. And this is the same class that shows kind of what happened with their ranking. So they had their activities in class, they had their assignments, and then they, again, refine, vote, and design. And they created the survey, they ranked their favorite assignments and activities, they included some fill-in options in case somebody had some other ideas. The students voted and they presented the results. And then once it was all agreed upon, they finalized the syllabus and then the learning for that class commenced. So it says, but in reality, the learning had already commenced because the students were already involved in content curation and actually developing something new. This really applies to the adult learning principle of relevancy and applicability. I mean, this and independence even and autonomy, because they became part of the course, part of what they wanted to learn and part of how they wanted to learn it. And so it was a very interactive, engaging form for them. Other community ideas, and this again, especially experiential learning, service learning classes, this is a really good thing, but you can identify a community problem and they can work together, you know, to define it. Like, this is an old recollection that I have, but I do know it was out in LA, I believe. And people began to say, you know, in some of these older neighborhoods that needed refurbishing, you know, and they had a lot of homeless population problems and stuff. Well, they began to plant gardens in the areas that were like the center of the roads. The can't remember what the word is for those things. It's leaving me right now, but in the center of the roads. And they began, instead of just using them as just wasted land, they began to plant gardens and they became community gardens and became a resolution to a problem that they had. Not only did it beautify the communities and make people want to then move on to other projects and beautify things, but it also, they were able to use some of it to feed some of the homeless that were around. Real world case studies, again, tying them to assignments that they can use to potentially solve problems that are global in nature. And so really getting them involved that goes outside of themselves, outside of their community, but looking at the state, the country, the nation, the world as a whole. Translations, as the one suggested about how they took somebody who was good to take the children's stories and translate it into Spanish. So translating an existing OER into another language. How-to videos. There's lots of those that abound today, especially on YouTube, but having students actually create the videos to demonstrate how to do something step by step. It can be something that is creative, that is relevant to them, and that is associated with the course topic, or it can be something directly within the course that you want them to create and show another student how to do something step by step. Anthologies would be like the collections of students selected and annotated readings. So, you know, having them go through all of the readings, having them critically think through them, having them research them, having them find what they need to find, and then creating these collections that they have created themselves, have procured for themselves. So as promised, open pedagogy and AI, the reason that I bring this up is because AI is such a big topic right now. And we're all, I think, probably in the same boat, struggling to understand it, learn how to use it, how to get ahead of it. We know our students are already using it. Many of us are already using it, but how to use it in an effective instructional and pedagogical way. And so this is one area that you can look at using it. So like ethics and literacy, where you can have discussions and projects related to the implications of AI as it relates to basically anything, business, education, medicine, any kind of other sectors. And it encourages critical thinking about what that means, you know, for our world, you know, how are we going to be impacted? Critical thinking through cases, interacting with virtual scenarios that can adapt in real time to students' decisions. So they're interacting with that virtual scenario. When they make a decision, this is really good for business and for medicine for that matter. But when they make a decision, they're going to get some feedback that's in real time, allowing them to go ahead and see what the consequences of their decisions are and maybe think about it again, you know, think critically about what they need to do. Going back to what Kevin was saying earlier about identifying and using the skill sets of the students in the course, competency tracking is another way to use AI for open pedagogy to track skills and competencies of students over time. It can provide them a dynamic portfolio to share later on, you know, with other institutions or with future employers. This can be open. It can be where people can also add more information to it. In all of these situations, they're collaborating and working together. Learning communities, you can use AI for peer matching to connect learners within the class or even outside of the class, if that's where you want to go with it. But connecting within the class for, you know, their complementary competencies or, you know, for projects or for study sessions or whatever it is that they need. And then, of course, we all are familiar with ChatGPT or getting familiar. We know the term at least. And so role playing, using the AI system to role play difficult conversations, you know, having difficult conversations, building quizzes, lesson plans, we've already talked about, increasing their critical thinking through comparison, analysis, and evaluation of the output information, because we all know that as good as it is, we have to double check, we have to do our own research with AI sources. And it's the whole point of these things is to increase their critical thinking, their autonomy, their ability to separate fact from fiction, their ability to understand, you know, the different kinds of things. I look at the role-playing challenging conversations and I look at how, wow, that would be really cool to use like in, say, counseling and psychology courses, for as an example, which, you know, you're going to be having challenging conversations, but also in business, HR, having difficult conversations with employers. So it can be, it can have both personal and other types of things. Medicine, you know, you often have to, you know, you have to develop that bedside manner and learning how to have those challenging conversations that are of a very personal and life and death kind of situation. So there are ways to be able to use AI in an open pedagogical style and make it worthwhile for the student. How to get started. Let me just go to that and then we'll go to some more questions. Basically, in order to get started, you review, you always look at your learning outcomes. We all know that. It's instructional design 101. Always look at your learning outcomes and what are the objectives that you're wanting students to learn. And then look within what you currently have to see what are the opportunities that students can contribute to developing OER content. And then review different assignment approaches. And for that, you're going to review some different resources. And I'm going to provide you some on the slides, but some different resources to see what are the different approaches for how I can do these different kinds of assignments. And then, as Kevin already mentioned, connect with your library, your instructional designer, your teaching and learning center, whatever, about the copyright licensing and about the tools and the platforms that are available, and also about accessibility. Because open pedagogy, just like OER, is not only about reducing costs, it is about removing barriers. And that is where the inclusivity comes in. And so we want to provide more access. And so we need to make sure that our materials are accessible. And then the last two slides that I will put up for you are the just different open pedagogy resources. I'm going to go to the, I think that's the last one I have actually. Yes, that's the last slide. So those are some resources that you can certainly look into and that can help you begin the open pedagogy or continue the open pedagogy journey.
Denise, great. I want to address a couple of comments and a couple of questions, some that were in the chat and some in the document. There are a couple of examples that were shared. So Amy referenced the project management for instructional design textbook that's been used. There's a great story behind that. And if everybody knows it, I'll stop. But if you don't, originally that textbook was based on a project management for construction, and that David Wiley, who's known in the open community, had a need to have something that was really talking about project management specific to instructional designers. And part of his assignment was for those students in the graduate program to go and change the case study stories at first to make those reflective of instructional design. And they systematically reworked that textbook from a construction-based project management book to an instructional design one. And then Mike Ford had a great one here, where he was collaboratively designing AI policy in the syllabus with his students. So there's another great way to partner with your students to set expectations and boundaries.
Yep, and that's just what we were talking about as far as all of the use of AI, whether it's AI or whether it's open pedagogy by itself, setting those boundaries and letting people and letting students be part of that conversation. And I think that's what's very important, because if you want them to be in a collaborative and creative state, then, you know, having that conversation to where they are part of the conversation, not just you delivering that information to them. I think that's very important, because it goes ahead and it role models and it sets the standard for what you're looking for.
And Lily had shared an open pedagogy portal. There's a number of resources out there. There's one that was out of North Carolina that I'm blanking on at the moment, but One of the comments that was made in the document was whether or not open pedagogy might reduce dropout rates because of the collaborative nature, you know, that students are part of a group work and they're not getting lost in the background. And there was a great resource that was shared in the document, but a comment I had added is that it really depends on the student's understanding of the value of the assignment. I have a colleague online here, Nicholas, who has shared perspectives in the past that while the students in the end will find value and will put extra work into this output, at the forefront, there may be some grumblings because they just really wanted to be in another 200 level class where all I had to do is sit in the back row and just take a test at the beginning, you know, and at the end.
Yeah.
So, you know, you if there's not that conversation at the beginning about what the value to the student is, and they're just seeing this as doing the instructor's work, you're going to have folks disengage and maybe even drop the course. But if there is that open dialogue at the beginning and really truly talking about how this is a benefit to the student and future students, then you can get that buy-in.
Right. I agree with that. That's very important because you're right. I mean, a lot of students, like we said, and it's human nature. You know, it's not that they're difficult students. It's just human nature. We tend to get familiar, and with what we're familiar, then we're comfortable with it. So as instructors, I know I have, as an instructor, I have had students oftentimes say to me, why can't we just answer vocabulary questions? Or why can't we just do whatever XYZ has done before? Well, because this isn't their course, and because we're doing something different. But having, that's why I say I think it's so important to include them in that conversation, because when you are wanting to hopefully mediate someone's thinking towards how they learn, then it's sometimes there's those skills have just not been promoted very well, you know, and they need, it's not that they don't have them necessarily, but they need to develop them, and they need to do so in an environment that is inclusive and is collaborative and gives good constructive feedback for them to where they can become comfortable with that kind of learning situation. So.
And I'd love to add a perspective as well, is that you may have a student that just does not want to be attributed to this public work. If that's the goal, is to publicly release, and that isn't a requirement with open pedagogy, you don't necessarily have to have something that is publicly available. But if your intent is to, and you have a student that's concerned, you know, there are alternate assignments you can do for those few students. Or if the issue is really the student putting their name, you can accept pen names or pseudonyms for those students if they, for whatever reason, do not want their name associated with the work. So there are ways to get around those types of concerns from students. But really, I'm going to keep going back to, you know, this conversation, this open conversation with students. And if it's your first time going through this, be open and honest and say, hey, we might make mistakes, but this is an iterative nature. The students next year are going to take your work and build upon it, but you are the foundation to this work. So just that open conversation so that students understand what they're investing their time and energy to and what the long-term goal is.
Right. And to build upon what you were just saying, Kevin, about some students may be somewhat resistant to put their name on something, we do have to be aware of FERPA restrictions and stuff. There are reasons sometimes that students do not want to use their name. And so we need to be aware that that can happen in any classroom. That can happen in normal group work, you know, where they don't want people, they don't want to do like a open Google Doc or an open, like I know a lot of students like to use GroupMe or other apps like that that are out there because they are, you know, real time kind of feedback. But there are some students that do not want to do that because they do not want their information out there. And so there are ways to get around that. And I appreciate you bringing that up because that's a very good point. And then just bringing their, you know, building those skills. And I think another thing to think of in terms of as an instructor is, do you want them, you know, like Kevin said, sometimes the perspective of a student might be, we're doing the faculty's work for them, and why should we do that? Well, that's not what the, you know, goal is, of course, but a way to kind of get around that too is to also have another kind of assignment that's built in that is actually something related to the course. It's not related necessarily to the syllabus or to the quizzes, but it's related to the course, like curating those types of articles and researches or annotated annotation, web annotations, things like that. I mean, curating some of that or creating like the children's storybook or think something like that, that it doesn't, it's an actual assignment. It is something that they are collaborating in and working on, but they are not necessarily creating something for the faculty's course. And so that's just a different way to look at it in terms of what do I start with first? You know, what are these, is this particular group of students going to possibly engage and interact and embrace?
There's some great resources that are embedded on this screen, as well as ones that have been shared in the document. But if you need to talk about the values of open pedagogy, right on the screen right here, Denise has, there's a great link right there. There's some a variety of things. The Open Pedagogy Notebook is a great resource that came, it generated out of the state of New Hampshire in a partnership with actually with BC Campus out of British Columbia. And there's a number of collections of use cases where faculty have shared open pedagogy assignments there. Mm-hmm. And I've shared a link in the doc in the chat about a sample student release form, but there's also a guide to making open textbooks link here that also includes a separate student agreement form. So if you're talking about how do you actually produce the final product, you know, and you want to make sure about FERPA and student IP concerns, you know, that release form and having that upfront conversation is just going to make that publication much smoother.
Right. I agree. I think that's a valuable document to have. And I think it also will increase student comfort. And the more comfortable they are, the more able they're going to be willing to engage and collaborate and create. I really like, too, the resource that's on here, that's the OE Global 23, Evaluating the Interplay Between AI, Open Pedagogy, and Competency-Based Learning. I thought that was very informative. It has a lot of good resources within it. I used a couple of their, a little bit of their material in terms of showing you some of that framing, but the, and then also the teaching with AI, which has a lot of great resources as far as like prompts and ChatGPT type assignments, and actual provides you with you know, examples of the assignment and prompting that you can do. I thought those were very very good you know, information. And the thing that I really, really like about all of these is that it, open pedagogy, when you really start looking at open pedagogy, you are just really, really playing into adult learning principles. And I think that is what is so important, because the goal behind most learning is, number one, you know, skill development, critical thinking, being able to think for yourself, being able to be independent, being able to be relevant in your world. And when we can provide, as faculty, we can provide assignments that have them have students actually engaging with that kind of material, it is so much more deeper cognitive learning that goes on, I think, than just hearing someone say it. We all know that just hearing something is, it only goes this far, but then when we actually engage in it and we're doing it, then the learning seems to go much deeper, and it sticks with us.
You have a request for the link to the OE Global one. I'm going to include a YouTube video, but I don't know if there is a different resource beyond that.
There was an actual website.
Well, we're finding that resource. I wonder if there are folks who are on this session who've used open pedagogy in the past that would love to share their experiences with the others. I know that we actually have one gentleman who was one of the references for one of the slides where we talked about sociology. and he's not shy. So I know he'll come on and share his perspectives if others don't, which is also a warning to others that if you don't share, he will.
I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing the screen if there's no other reason for me to share it right now. I'll just stop sharing the screen, and then I'm going to try to find that resource and put the link in the chat.
Let's see here. Okay. Nicholas, why don't you come off mute and tell us a little bit about how you've got your student work to be published as part of OpenStax?
That's a very interesting story. Thank you for asking, Kevin. So when I started to use Introduction to Sociology from OpenStax, the supplemental material were not very interesting. And I decided to work with my students to create some supplemental material. And it really helped students to explore the material through a very different perspective. So instead of just reading the material, taking the quiz and being done with it, they started to create the quizzes. They started to create discussion questions. They also created the PowerPoints. And they did all the work by thinking that it will be used by other students. And they were really more involved in the creation. So I was teaching two classes in the spring and in the fall. And what happened was the work done by one class was reviewed by another class. And it was really creating a very interesting connection between students. And when it was done, I decided to do something crazy. I contacted OpenStax and say, hey, it's what we did. And some of the work my students and I did was good, and it was it's used by OpenStax.
What we talked a little bit yesterday, Lily Dubach and I, in our OER basics, was that, you know, it doesn't always have to be perfect. You know, the perfection is the enemy of good. And, you know, your students did really good work, and OpenStax saw the value of it. So I can't guarantee that every faculty student interaction is going to produce the same thing, but Nicholas took a stab at it and just offered it up to OpenStax, and they accepted. Nicholas, thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
Does anyone else have any stories that they'd like to share about their open pedagogy experiences?
I can share something. I really appreciate this topic, this particular session. So thank you very much. A lot of valuable resources. One of the things, this is Bob from Rollins College, by the way. One of the things that we've been kind of working on and had this in class, our student created podcasts with the intention of the class next semester will take the subject. In this case, it's called the podcast, BODcast, because it's about, and it's going to sound a little strange, but how you feel, what you recognized as you explore who you are, you know, who the student is, and was there a memory associated or a sound associated or a trauma associated with if I remember, I don't have it up on my screen right now, but with a part of your body. So that can be your mind, but it can also be your arm. It can be whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. And there has to be a lot of screening of the material that the students are creating, because I think we may naturally think, oh, it's going to be about sexual trauma, or it's going to be about whatever, but it could be about how your leg healed during from a car accident, or it could be you're a student who has a mental illness or mental health issue, and how they work through that to hopefully accomplish something worthwhile. And we have a small radio station that we can air those on, but we also have an archive through our library that the students, you know, can share. So the exemplary podcasts are chosen by the faculty member, as well as someone from the archives and the student media director. But those are shared outward. And then next semester, she just started this project through a grant project with us. The instructor is intending for her new students to listen to the well done exemplars and then build on that. And it's a communication class, so they're learning about how they communicate, you know, on those types of topics and so forth. And it turned out really, really well. The students were heavily involved, very eager to produce high quality. And I just want to say a little an anecdote. When I went over and talked to them, that age group, the typical age group of freshmen and sophomore students, when you say podcast, they associate that with the internet. They don't associate it with NPR or a radio station. And it's just kind of a generation gap thing there. But there's a lot of resources that are freely available to use through NPR sources as well for that particular type of activity. So I thought I would just share that.
That's fantastic, Bob. If you're at liberty, if you could share a link to any of those resources, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, I will go ahead and share what I can.
Great.
I think it'd be very useful. And one of the things that I think that was really clear in that whole exercise of creating that podcast was that you have a prompt, you have a topic that is obviously of great interest, you know, for students. And that's one of the things that pulls them in. And I think when we're thinking in terms of, you know, whether it be discussions or groups or however we're going to use open pedagogy, it's the topic or the prompt or however we're putting it out there, that's what is number one, what grabs their attention. You know, that is what's going to grab their attention. So if that's on us to try to make that, you know, interactive and something that they can embrace, and that way they can work together, because if it's just dry material, it's not going to work. So podcast, which they equate to internet, whatever, you know, I mean, it's still electronic kinds of stuff. You know, it's not just dry material. It's not just reading stuff, and they're able to share and they're able to collaborate. And I think that's awesome. That's a really great example.
I'm getting the high sign that we've got 1 minute left. And what I would love to do is just ask the folks to keep a link to this document, and you know, let's continue to add to it. If you do have questions, we'll come back and we'll revisit it. If you've contributed to this document, and if you'd like to find a way to add your name to this document, would love to see this thing grow into a useful resource, not necessarily to compete with the Open Pedagogy Network or the portal that Lily had shared. But, you know, if we can start collecting more resources and distribute those, we're happy to do that. Rocco, thanks for sending the link. Denise, I'll let you have the last words.
I think that there's a lot of resources out there that are available to us. In fact, so many oftentimes I think that we can feel overwhelmed. It isn't about having to use every single resource, but find a few good ones that are aligned with what it is that you're wanting to do. And open pedagogy, because it is so much aligned with adult learning principles and so much aligned with inclusion and, applicability and relevance, I think that is so clearly the way for us to go in terms of teaching students, because we're wanting them to be independent and we're wanting them to be contributing members of society. And everyone, while they may need to build some skill, most people have a great interest in creating and developing their own learning and being a part of that, collaborating in how they learn. And I think that that's what open pedagogy is really all about. And with that said,
we appreciate you all joining us. If you have the opportunity at 4 p.m. Eastern time, Amy DeNoyles, who's online right now, will be facilitating a student panel. And if you were part of the conversation earlier, our own Wiki Nights will be part of that. And we'll be talking a little bit about student advocacy. So please come back at 4 p.m. Eastern if you can. If not, hopefully you'll join us tomorrow. But thank you all.
Thank you.